So thank you all for coming back and having a seat. So we're going to have a little panel here to talk about the movie. First, I'll introduce Jim Bruce here, who came here. Here's a mic for you. And
thank you.
He's the director of the movie. Is that the appropriate title?
I am. Producer, okay. Director, too many things.
Okay. Producer, director, writer, probably.
Editor.
Probably it's a few other functions.
Assistant.
And as I mentioned when we got started, that was a condensed version of the film that was about 60 of what could be a 109 minutes or 100 minutes. So we also have some outtakes. I don't know if you want me to find those, I can do that. Or
we could queue it up, or we could do something.
Okay, I'll take a look and
via email. Janet Yellen's interview outtakes include a few interesting comments, so we gathered a few of them together.
Right. So also on the stage here, we have Steen Jakobsen, and Steen's going to be presenting tomorrow. He came all the way from Copenhagen, so he gets potentially the furthest traveled award, although I just met someone from Singapore, and I have no idea which one's further away. Anyone?
Singapore.
Probably Singapore. Okay. And then Axel, who you've already heard from, and at the end, we've got John Hussman, who will also be presenting tomorrow. And so I'll kind of let Jim take the lead on this. Let the other panelists weigh in. Just raise your hand if you want to ask a question, and I'll ask whoever has the mic at the time to repeat the question so we make sure we catch it on video for those who are not with us down the road. Thank you.
Thank you, JJ. I just want to say thanks for inviting me here. I'm excited to talk about the film and the Fed with you guys. And just a couple of quick housekeeping things. The film came out late last year, but we are trying to get it out into the general population even further than we have so far. It's been in theaters. It's been at a lot of universities and financial offices around the world. But if you're interested in connecting us with a school or an office or anyone who might be interested in getting people thinking about the Fed, please introduce yourself, or we've got a little sign-in sheet over there. One exciting thing for me is to be on a panel with John Hussman, who is someone that I was reading as a small investor. I was a shareholder from, I think, around 2001 or two onward. I was someone working in film, and that's my only professional background, but I got interested around 1999 and 2000 in the markets, in what was happening there at the time, and I think they've been interesting ever since. And I began reading people like John, who were looking at things differently, especially in the early to mid-2000s. And I actually wound up making a fair amount of money during the financial crisis, shorting financial stocks in 07 and 08 as a real rookie investor. I didn't have enough capital, so I bought puts. and that turned out well. And it was enough to sort of put a down payment on the film. And then we raised the money through donations and Kickstarter, and the way you normally raise money for documentary films. But I really think the Fed has had a huge impact on markets, on our economy. And then really, we tell it more in the longer version of the film for general audiences, a big impact on our society. And the choices people make, the incentives the Fed is giving out, I think has really changed people's lives and continue to change people's lives. And I made the film because I think we need to reconsider some of these incentives that we're using the power of our central bank to put into place. So with that, I'll kick
Jim,
it over.
You mentioned put options. What's interesting in 2007, when we were at sort of the peak of the bubble, one of the things that we were writing about was that investors who believe that they have a Bernanke put or a Federal Reserve put to save them may find out that put option has a strike price that is way out of the money.
Yep.
And it's interesting.
Was it 670, I think, on the S&P?
Yeah. And so I think there is a conception, by the way, loved the film.
Thank
so
you.
I think it's really helpful for people because what's happened since the late 90s is really a long-running narrative of the Federal Reserve persistently following a strategy of trying to force individuals to chase yield. First, we got the internet bubble and the technology bubble. Then, in response to the 2000-2002 decline, which the Federal Reserve was easing the whole time. So, you know, we lost 50% of market value in an environment where the Federal Reserve was persistently trying to go against that, which is kind of an interesting thing for the don't fight the Fed people. But then we got into 2002, and the Fed tried it again. And in this case, didn't provoke an equity bubble as much as the housing bubble. People sought yield. Wall Street thought, well, you know, people are looking for something to buy to earn interest. Housing's never gone down. People had a real appetite for getting any higher yield. So they threw money into mortgage securities, and Wall Street was more than happy to oblige. And so we got another housing bubble. That collapsed. The Federal Reserve, again, was easing the whole time down. But the, you know, the consequences of having created the bubble did the same thing. And my concern is that the Fed has done exactly the same thing again. And the only thing that keeps people from seeing it is that profit margins, for different reasons, are at record highs. And so, you know, on normalized valuations, people would see equity prices much more extreme, and the danger is much more extreme.
Yeah, I mean, it seems to me what the environment now just seems like a mixture of the late 90s and the early to mid 2000s, and it's different. And the problem is, I think you see people saying, well, the tech stocks aren't as overpriced as they were in 1999 or 2000, so there's room to run, you know, that kind of thing. And housing, you know, I think housing, actually, the recent acceleration in housing outpaced anything that happened during the bubble. But again, housing prices are not, in some areas, San Francisco, they're clearly out of whack. But it's not as far out of whack as the biggest bubble in history. So people are having a hard time reading this environment, reading these signals.
If I can just jump in here, and I don't remember now whether I mentioned it earlier, but to me, the best bubble indicator I've had in my career is complacency. And complacency is, in the market, expressed in a lack of volatility. When an asset or asset class has a volatility below its historic average, it attracts capital that is not fully appreciative of the risks that come with that. Be that in the internet boom, be that in housing, or be that in the bond market. Most folks, they listen to CNBC and whatnot, they actually never actually run the numbers. Investing in the bond market is, you're up for a wild ride. There is volatility at the long end of the yield curve. And when for quite an extended period, that volatility is compressed and you make money all the time, well, of course, you pour your money in. Same thing with investing in local debt securities, fixed income securities in emerging markets. Or now if you take the stock market, if valuations go up, or prices go up, but volatility goes down, that means people are jumping on board, not fully appreciative that historically the annualized standard deviation in the stock market is in the 20% range, but it can range from now in the low to mid-teens to as high as 40%. Well, if you think it's going to be in the low teens, the moment that volatility picks up, you're going to be running for the hills. Now, timing that is very difficult. But the question is, of course, always at what stage do you want to kind of take a step back and get away? You're not going to lose money except your purchasing power if you're not invested in the market. And so it's always a question of how much risk can you take. And I have some views on that, but I'll let you run the show, yeah.
Mm-hmm. I just want to throw it open to some, Steen, would you like to jump in?
It's, first of all, nice to be in an audience that's more negative than me. It doesn't happen very often. Actually, I'm normally introduced to someone who's predicted five of the last two crises. But I can tell here I'm in an audience of a much better crowd in terms of that. Jim, congratulations on the movie. I thought it was a great movie, too. I do think, however, both this morning's conversation, and to some extent the movie as well, continues to dwell on history instead of looking forward. I think that is maybe one of the classic mistakes of trying to explain something ex post instead of looking at the future. And, you know, in my job, I get to, unfortunately, to some extent, travel to 30, 35 countries on an average year. And I can tell you one thing, whether you come from the far left, the far left, right, the middle, in between, there is no one solution for all this. And I think continuing to look, as you've done all morning, on the stock, i.e. how much debt is there in the world, is irrelevant because the policymaker looks at the flow. The flow is the fact, can we service this debt? And if we serve as a debt, how do we get out of this debt? And that leads to my main conclusion, and the, just to be the devil's advocate on a great movie. What is missing here is that how do we create new growth? And I think it's important for you to understand that if you look at total factor productivity, which essentially is growth, if we break that down into its components, so how do we as a society over time create growth? And it says a lot about this talk this morning. So what comes up then is that 56% of all growth is created through productivity. That means you as individuals, you as business people, you engaging, improving the process of which you're doing your industrial work or everything you do in a daily life. Capital, the only thing you talk about this morning, is less than 20%. The rest is labor improvement, so your ability to work. So we're talking about 20% of the total productivity. I think your movie, to some extent, over-exaggerates the problem of the Federal Reserve relatively to this situation we need to deal with, because debt can be reduced in two ways: debt forgiveness, which I think is imminent, certainly in Europe, and secondly, through growing the society again. And I think that's where the world, and where I'm in an audience that seems too negative in terms of what comes next. In my opinion, 14 is the low in every single factor you can find in the world. So there's a good reason why the attendance is down, and why, you know, some people are, you know, over everything. But we have to learn, and that's be my final word, that the only way we improve individually, but also as a society, is through failing. So your film is important as a milestone of how we fail to use, you know, the best economic environment in the world to actually create the next plateau, the next environment. And then finally, as an economist, I have to be concerned that we continue to think that we can continue to grow. There is no mathematical, practical reasoning why society will continue to grow. The world is a finite place in terms of resources. It's a finite place in terms of its ability to create growth. We have probably reached that limit, so maybe we should start talking about quality growth instead of nominal growth. And that is exactly why Asia is slowing down. They have taken that decision out of need, mind you, again, through a crisis. But that, I think, is the conversation we need to have for the next 2 to 3 years.
To follow up on something that you said about productivity, I think not only the actions of the Federal Reserve have been important in holding back gross domestic investment, because gross domestic investment has stagnated as a share of GDP, and it has grown, I think, at about a 1% annual rate since 1998, something like 15, 16 years. So very difficult growth there. But even the gross domestic investment that we've done has been into yield-seeking type behavior and misallocation. So if we're concerned about economics, and we're concerned about economic growth and real economic growth, and not just about the financial markets, we should also be concerned, I think, about this yield-seeking behavior that the Federal Reserve produces, because we misallocate resources again and again to areas that are speculative rather than areas that are productive. A productive economy is an economy that allocates capital to productive uses. And to the extent that the Federal Reserve's policies get into the way of that, we may have, you know, a direct effect in terms of, you know, sort of discouraging investment and creating uncertainty and that sort of thing. But we also have these indirect effects in terms of making the investment that we do initiate much less productive, because we've created a lot of things that just went away. And
I just want to throw in one more word here in this context. We work a lot with Bill Poole, who was also featured in this movie. And his argument is a little bit along your lines, that there's a lot that should be done on regulatory and tax policy to get growth going. And he turns that the other way around. He says the role of a central bank these days should be to tell the government that they have done enough at the monetary side, and that you cannot fix all these problems with monetary policy, and you got to do something on the fiscal side. If you look at what Draghi had been doing throughout the financial crisis, he intentionally didn't print as much money. And the blogosphere always says, oh, the Europeans have printed all this money. No, they haven't. That's one of the main reasons you had the crisis blow out, because he actually held many of these governments accountable, held them on a short leash. Now he's changed his tune. He says, well, so much austerity, so much pain, it's a little too much, and now let's change course. And you we disagree with that. But anyway, but it is the role also of a central bank to tell the government, no, you can't always use the printing press. Now, obviously, that should have come much earlier. But Bernanke was most reluctant to, when he, in his hearings, was most reluctant to say, you're going to come to agreement on entitlement reform and so forth. Greenspan did a little bit more of that. We'll see whether Janet Yellen does any of that. But there is so much more that could be coming from that microphone at the Fed to tell policymakers, it's your job now. We have done enough. We'll let rates go back up. And you better deal with the deficit, because otherwise you're going to have a big problem. And so all these warnings are coming on always on a very, very shallow basis only.
Yeah, I mean, just to speak real quick, and then we'll open it up. I agree completely with the views here. You know, I think we focus so much on the Fed in the film, but ironically, I view the Fed, and I think this applies to investors as well, as just an enormous distraction. So these asset price booms get everyone's attention, and they focus activity on housing, or everyone's remodeling their kitchen, or whatever it is, and they create a lot of noise in our economy, and I think it's hurtful for economic growth. And the strange thing is, we know that central banks can't create economic growth or accelerate it in the long run. You can change nominal prices, but you can't really, they don't really have the power to do what they're trying to do. And yet we know that investing in education and in, you know, research and development, that we know what actually makes people better off and what could improve people's standards of living, but we're distracted, I think, by these big asset price booms, which have been really the story of the last 15 years. And I think investors are distracted by that. Instead of saying, where can I put my money? You know, it's what's up 30% in the last 2 weeks, you know, or whatever. You know, people are really chasing returns because we live in these, we've been living in these asset, you know, asset bubbles, really. So I think, ironically, we focus so much on the Fed, but to me, the solutions all really lie elsewhere. And I think as investors, there's something there where it's, you know, to what extent are the asset prices you're looking at affected by people's impression of Fed policy? And how can you filter out that noise and try to find real value in terms of how you're allocating capital? Fish?
Yeah, I asked Axel if I can put you on the spot here. And I actually, Steen, last night I had the pleasure of having dinner with. What happens if we, you know, should we in fractional reserve lending, was my question. And he said, well, what does it matter what you or I think, because it's not going to happen. So, okay, so presuming that it's not going to happen, and presuming that the Fed then keeps on its same policy, because we've certainly seen no policy changes here on the Fed, from forever blowing higher and higher and higher bubbles, and an increasing amplitude on the boom-bust cycles, as I've written on my blog many times. So, you know, where does it end? If it doesn't end with fractional reserve lending, if it doesn't end with gold, if it doesn't end with some sort of market controls coming back in and saying, look, guys, this doesn't work, you know, is the end World War III? Is the end a big escalation in the price of gold? Both of those. I mean, I'm a big believer in productivity. But one of the things that we have with productivity is that should force prices lower over time. I just did a post the other day on housing. There are 3D printing houses now. It's absolutely incredible. You know, what they can build contours out of layered concrete now. That's going to drive the prices lower, yet central banks are hell-bent on driving the prices higher. So we have these two conflicting forces here that are both very, very major, and we say, well, nothing's going to change, so something has to change.
Well, the naive answer is it's only money, right? I mean, but in truth, answer to both questions is yes. I mean, the one about World War III and gold. The political, there's a reason why the Great Depression ended in World War II. It's because you're going to blame somebody else for the problems that you have. And the political stability is on the decline. That's why we have these challenges pop up. And obviously, every crisis has its little special definition and an explanation. And what's going to happen is, I mean, there are different ways you can deal with debt. You can, on the most obvious level, you can inflate it away, or you can default on it. Or you pay it off because you outgrow it. Now, the challenges with the demographics we have, we are better off in the U.S. than in Europe. It's very difficult to outgrow it, especially if we're already in such a levered society. Now, can you do things on growth? Definitely. I mean, I see it in our own business. The cost of doing business has exploded, not just for our firm, but our industry as a whole. There's so many things that we could unleash forces. And so some of these things are cyclical. But at the same time, yes, the issues are tremendous. And we're going to move more towards a Latin American type of society. And with that come all kinds of consequences. But fear not, politicians will not blame themselves. They'll blame somebody, blame you, and take the money from the wealthy to try to quote unquote fix the system, and let there be the next crisis, and I'm sure they'll put again in regulations that make things worse. I mean, I think we chatted also about just about all the regulations that were put in since the financial crisis don't address the issues. They hinder growth, but they don't make the system any safer. And so, but fear not, that's what our politicians do. They'll get involved and make the next problem worse. And so, because we've now stifled growth with all these regulations, maybe some of this explosion of the cyclicality is going to be tamed, but the underlying forces are the same. So ultimately, you have ongoing disintegration. Now, of course, there is an opportunity that maybe we come to entitlement reform, maybe we can come to sustainable budget. I just don't see that happening with the political dynamics as they play out. And so for that to happen, it would need the pressure of the bond market, and that would be a rough period. We could get through it, and yes, we don't need that World War III, but that's a risk that can happen in this scenario. Unfortunately, not a negligible one.
We've talked about government interest rates are needed to keep the debt payments low, and yet unfunded liabilities are so much bigger than traditional debt. So and unfunded liabilities are rooting for inflation, higher interest rates. So there's a lot of talk about, man, what happens if our average weighted cost of paying off the interest was 4% or 5%. That would hurt the traditional debt payment, but it would help the unfunded liabilities. So can you talk about the conflict there and some possible outcomes?
I'd like to throw a couple of comments out. First of all, we do have, and this came up in one of the earlier sessions, enormous amounts of debt and enormous amounts of equity market capitalization, but those assets have to be paired with long-term cash flows that service them in one way or the other, either in terms of dividends and other cash flows, or in terms of interest. The economy produces so much of that, and to the extent that the assets are enormous relative to those cash flows, we are in a world where it's very likely that pension assumptions are going to be wrong, and significantly wrong. Because, for instance, our estimate of 10-year prospective returns on the S&P 500 are right around 2.4%. You've got Treasury bonds yielding about 2.6%. You've got shorter-term debt yielding less. You've got, junk bonds yielding about 5%, which is scary, because the historical default rate on junk debt is about 5%. So the prospective after default rate of return is next to nothing. And so pension assumptions are going to be disappointing. My sense is that unfunded liabilities have the same outcome, is that if we continue to misallocate capital and not fund productivity, we will end up in a world where those promises can't be kept. And I think that's one of the important features of the investment environment that individuals have to take account of, because for a long-term investor in unhedged equities, my sense is that what they can expect to have on the table 7 years from now is already on the table here. The hope is that we get changes in volatility, and that we, with those changes in volatility, get asset prices that are somewhat cheaper. We get other opportunities to lock in higher rates of return. Unfortunately for the economy as a whole, that's something of a zero-sum game, because we can't, in an economy that's not productive In an economy that doesn't allocate capital well, you can't squeeze returns out for everybody. You have to have something of a zero-sum game. And so that's I think, one of the big challenges that Fed policy has already baked in the cake. And then on regulation, I just have one point, which is that I actually am a big fan of capital regulations. So in other words, greater bank capital, and particularly, you know, things like, you know, mandatory convertible debt on the asset side of the balance sheet, so that when financial companies do get into trouble, there's something left on the equity side to get into, so that you don't have defaults. That said, I agree with you that most of the regulations that have gone into place don't address capital adequacy. My view on the recovery continues to be that the Federal Reserve did not turn the economy around in 2009. What turned the economy around in 2009 was the change by the Financial Asset Standards Board to FAS 157 that eliminated mark-to-market accounting and suddenly scratched the likelihood of insolvency off the table, because banks could just revalue their assets. That happened in the second week of March, and that corresponded almost precisely, in hindsight, of course, wish we would have been aware that everyone would believe it.
I was just going to say, along those lines, I mean, I really do think we're in a psychological situation where the Fed, I agree with John somewhat, not completely, but in terms of what's turned this around is a feedback loop that I think is attributed to the Fed. And that's a psychological support for the market that anybody on CNBC for the last 3 years has been telling you about, really since David Tepper kind of started it. We have that clip in the film saying, you know, the market can only fall so much. I think we have to expect that changes that psychological support. And really, it's all about what the Fed is doing now. They're trying to step out of the way. It could be kind of a typical cycle where markets turn not long after the Fed turns. And so I think you have to expect that psychological support really isn't going to be there very long. And then you have to think about what's the real price of this asset going forward.
I'd like to make two quick comments, one on central banking and then one following up on the regulatory side. I don't know whether many of you are aware that in New Zealand, in the general election that's coming up, monetary policy is a hot topic. And one of the ideas that's been floated around is whether the central bank should be setting the pension assumptions and periodically revise them. Now, it's an interesting point for debate. The problem in this case is that it's going to be increasingly politicized, and with that, you don't necessarily come up with a better result, even though some of these ideas might sound fine in theory. Regarding John's point, I would fully be in agreement. The specific issue you're raising is a market-based solution to a regulatory problem. And specifically, one of the ideas that's been floated around in academia forever, which is, in my view, a very prudent one, is you can have companies have staggered subordinate capital that they have to then refine and say over a 10-year basis. And so if the market deems an entity to be not safe enough, they say have to shrink 10% a year. That's not going to cause a systemic problem, because then they can't refinance themselves at an acceptable cost. But you don't have these things where you suddenly run against the wall. And so similarly, you need, that's for example a tool. Another tool is that if you use leverage, well, you post collateral and you mark to market. Bingo. You don't need anything else anymore. And you have a stable financial system. And you don't need to have hundreds of people sitting around in these investment banks. The economy works because of greed. You just have to channel that greed in a productive fashion. And there will always be some abuse, but if you're trying to, you're not going to have any abuse if you don't allow economic activity. But as soon as you allow economic activity, there's going to be abuse. And so you got to find a way to take care of most of these issues. And the important thing is the government should not regulate a way that you make a stupid decision. What the government's role is that to make sure that when you make a stupid choice, that it doesn't wreck the system as a whole. And that's something that policymakers sometimes forget, and then they get too involved in your daily lives, not just in the financial world.
One interesting thing in Janet Yellen's interview, we don't have that outtake here, but she is a fan of more stringent capital requirements. So I think, you know, the same way a politician likes to at some point trot out their own policy, I feel like that could be something that she runs with, this idea that we actually are going to be kind of tough on banks.
She definitely will, because she is not too interested in monetary policy. She is interested in regulation. Having said that, it's not going to work. In a short term, it dampens economic activity, but let there be economic growth. Well, JP Morgan is going to be able to raise more capital. She is not going to be able to constrain economic growth by changing capital adequacy ratios. Good luck with that. And then so she's going to have her hands full regulating things, and she's not going to succeed.
Yeah. Sorry, over here.
So looking forward in the future, should we learn to eat sushi because we're coming Japanese?
We'll let give it to Steen.
Yeah, the Danes eat fish. Yeah.
should we become like Japan, or should we? What was the other 70s? Yeah. I again think the conversation is very negative. I mean, it's like, you know, the unfunded liabilities are called unfunded liabilities for a reason. They're never going to be funded, right? And there is precedence, going back to the Japanese question, because in Japan, I'd probably not notice, but the pension age in Japan has gone up by 6 years over the last decade. And that will be the case in the U.S. So if any of you guys think you're going to be, you know, retiring at the age which your pension is presently indicating, you can add certainly 5, if not 10 years. The longer we stay in this environment of zero bound, the longer it will take. Other thing is, which is a mistake in my opinion in the movie, there is precedence for what goes on right now, and that was after the 1940, in the end of the 1940s, the Fed was also doing quantitative easing, and what happened then was that they had to stop it because they decided the program. I think Eisenhower was introducing at the time. Is that right? You are the Americans here, but I think Eisenhower has this proactive work labor deal. Didn't work, so they stopped doing the quantitative easing. It created a very deep recession. The very deep recession made all the bond markets, everyone buy the bond market. So through virtue of making a depression, of course, they created the demand for the bonds and they reduced it. But what's interesting, what followed was the 1950s, and that is my point here. You have to remember the rule of compounding. The most important rule in finance, in math, is the rule of 72. You take whatever number of 72 divided by whatever growth you have in the world. So right now the U.S. is not, I mean, the growth in the U.S. in Q1 was 0.1%, which means it will take 720 years to double the GDP. The growth, wrongly, of course, but in China is 7.2 for argument's sake. It will take them 10 years to double the GDP. But the point is, if you move from what is essentially a 2% growth economy to a 4%, it's not just a doubling, compounded, is a massive change. You saw that during the Clinton years where you went from a massive deficit to a surplus. And you know what Clinton government was good at? Doing absolutely nothing. Except, of course, smoking a few cigars. And that is the important point. I think what we really need to focus on is the fact that macro, any of us actually knowing what goes on, is waste of time. When I go around the world and I get into fights with a lot of central bankers about this, my sort of best wish for Christmas every year when I write to Santa Claus is to just do nothing, get all the world's central bankers, all the world's politicians, all of the world's John Hussman and Steen Jakobsens into a situation where you call the Prime Minister of Australia and you tell him, listen, Mr. Prime Minister, can we borrow a big plot of land, put in restaurant, tennis courts, hookers, whatever these guys always use anyway, and make a radio silence for 5 years, and I guarantee you the world will be a better place. And that is exactly what needs to happen. And that is, you know, Mike, there is an alternative. The alternative is that ultimately this breaks down whatever way. It's on its way, in my opinion, on the margin. But also, your time horizon is very short. I mean, you're expecting something, you know, a normal cycle is 7 years. We are, into 5 or 6 years of this cycle. I mean, in history since World War II in the U.S., you had a recession every 6 years, so it's due. I think this year will be the lowest growth you've seen. It is not the weather, by the way. And finally, I'll say this, that if you look at the way to come back for being productive, it is the SMEs. The U.S., 70% of all jobs in the U.S. is in the SMEs. And the reason it doesn't work right now is what I call the 80-20 rule. Do you realize that listed companies constitute less than 20% of your economy, but they get 100% of the capital? So QE, all, exclusively goes to the 20% of the companies as a list that have access to the Federal Reserve window indirectly through the banks they have, which means that you have 80% of the economy being choked. Imagine if you gave the 80% of the economy 10% of the credit availability. Imagine what that would do to velocity of money. Then you can all start buying the gold you seem so much in love with here. Because inflation only comes from the fact that you have a disbelief in the monetary system, which to some extent your movie is about, or the fact that loan demand comes back. Loan demand will come back, but only when you create this environment for the SMEs to come back. So essentially, you can ask us all the questions you want, but what I want you to go and do when this seminar is over, to go back and invest locally. The best return, the best way to secure your unfunded liabilities is to invest in local businesses, in local business people, bridge the loans they need to make sure the credit intermediation goes from the banks, goes back to you as investors. I guarantee you in Europe, in wherever I go in the world, the highest gross margin with the lowest risk you can have is lending to SMEs. And by the way, the average default on a SME portfolio is exactly the same as it is on the blue chip.
Great. I'm just going to quickly jump in. I think of it as fire or ice, you know, the bell bottoms or sushi thing. How is this going to end? And I think the tricky thing is the Fed has purposefully created a very challenging environment. They're trying to get people to respond a certain way, to take more risk. But I think you have to play both ends, and you have to think about the timing. I think ice and then fire down the road. I have some 30-year bonds that nobody wanted a few months ago. So I think there's different ways, there's different things that you can, I think you really have to invest for all outcomes right now. I think it's very hard. I think you have to diversify yourself for outcomes that are much more volatile, much broader than what we've seen in the last, you know, 20, 30 years.
Yeah, I want to follow up on what Steen said. I think there is clearly the possibility of having hope and having good economic growth and all these other things. The part of the problem is that a lot of the policies that we have stand in the way of that. And so that's really the source of my own pessimism. If you look back at the late 1940s, it's true the Federal Reserve allowed the monetary base to expand at that point beyond about 15 cents per dollar of GDP, and that's a lot. Right now we're at about 24, but that's psychotic. But even after that late 40s incident, what is not very often remembered is that over the next decade, the consumer price index increased by about 70%. We did get a lot of economic growth as well, but a lot of that was because we were redirecting resources from war efforts to peacetime efforts. We did have productive allocation of capital, and those are the things that we would love to get back to. We want in this environment that we're in to have productive investment, to have smaller businesses expanding employment, you know, local efforts to you know, reduce the burden on investment, R&D, and so forth, so that we can get both an increase in capital, an increase in labor force participation. And if we did that well, and if we stopped trying to push bubble, yield seeking, thinking that a higher price of an asset means you're wealthier, well, no, it doesn't. It just means that the price now has captured all of the future returns that you would have earned over time. It's a reallocation of future returns to the current price of the security. That's not wealth. That's just a redistribution across time. When you go to spend that money, you're not going to be able to buy more than you would otherwise. And the only way to realize the wealth with the inflated asset is to sell it to some other poor Joe who is going to end up getting less over time because you ended up getting more. So if we can get ourselves away from those policies and we can get ourselves toward more productive allocations from capital, I'm not nearly as pessimistic. The problem is that policymakers don't seem to be on that course.
I'd like to mention one area where I agree with Steen and elaborate on that a little bit. First, I saw some question marks earlier. SMEs are small and medium-sized enterprises, so the small businesses, basically. one of the things I'm fully in agreement with is that if you want to invest somewhere, just because you can buy it with a push of a button nowadays doesn't mean it's a good idea. If you want to invest in emerging markets, well, roll up your sleeves, ideally move there, and get your hands dirty. But by outsourcing it, by giving it to some stock market, why do you think that somebody's going to preserve your interests? To give you an example, in the 90s, I once complained to a German regulator about management of a business lying in public. It was extremely obvious. And they came back and says, well, we're going to investigate whether there was insider trading. There's nothing BaFin, the German bank regulator, has ever done that's useful. And on insider trading, they've never identified really any problems either. And that's in a developed economy. So why do you think that in emerging markets or in some more exotic places, the financial markets are going to be transparent? And here, at least, we are made believe that they're reasonably transparent and effective or efficient. And so if you put down your money, you got to do your homework with any investment. And then conversely, yes, investing in your neighborhood is sometimes one of the better ideas. And so your investment universe goes beyond the S&P. It goes to also not just bonds. It goes to alternatives. It goes to lifestyle, currencies, or whatever it is. Yeah. Documentaries, yeah. Exactly.
I don't recommend that's a great documentaries. Way to
lose money. You don't get rich making documentaries.
It's more of a vocation. We'll go with you.
Yes. I thought the movie was wonderful. Congratulations. And I think the line I liked the best in the movie was the line that said, the public wouldn't tolerate inflation anymore, when speaking about the 70s experience. And in that socioeconomic sense, I thought that was a beautiful socioeconomic statement, that in that sense, Paul Volcker wasn't a cause, he was a result. And I'm wondering if we're in the same kind of nexus right now, and what the issues are that will cause another Paul Volcker type individual to arise. And I think the issues now, of course, I think, are employment. The disemployment situation is perverse and it's horrible. And I think that, and people know that, I mean, they're living it. And I think that's the analogy to the 70s. And so I would say it's neither Japan nor the 70s, because the American public wouldn't live with either one anymore.
Right. You know, I mean, it's a great comment. I'm glad you responded to that line, which I also like. I think we're a bear market away from maybe having a different perspective on asset price inflation. I think you could substitute, if you think about the 80s, the 90s, and recent years, to me what's been happening is we've had very easy monetary policy in a world with globalization and rapid globalization and rapid technological change. So in a deflationary world, the Fed has been able to be so aggressive, and it's showed up in some cases as inflation, but largely as asset inflation. And the general public sort of been brought along for these booms, thinking each time that this is just a free lunch or it's something that's just good. And I hope at the end of this current asset boom, there'll be a different perception of asset price booms that are based on central bank policy. And will the same way people were fed up with inflation as a result of Fed policy, there'll be this sense that we need to direct our economy some other way. That to me it's just a terrible way of trying to grow an economy. And so I hope we have that public shift, but clearly, CNBC would differ.
Don't bet on that public shift happening too quickly. And the reason why I don't think so is because we have been conditioned to believe the Fed can solve any problem we have. The public, I mean, not this audience, but the public in general. Why on earth do deficits matter? You can always print some money. I mean, I've seen it firsthand. My daughter spoke in front of the Palo Alto City Council to beg them not to shut down the local dog shelter. They didn't, ultimately. They postponed the decision. Palo Alto is a reasonably well-functioning city. Well, if you can't shut down a dog shelter, how can you tackle the big problems? I mean, and it's just so much easier to just say, hey, let's print a little bit more money. And giving up entitlements, and to some people that's a world-order word, but giving up any sort of benefit is tough. And so people are not used to pain anymore. And so when you can say, hey, we'll print a little bit more money and we'll push the problem down the road, well, so be it. And so what's going to happen? And of course, culturally, different places in the world act with this differently. I mean, the Germans are the only ones that appear to love austerity. Until now, they have a new coalition government, and that seems to be going by the wayside as well. And so as an investor, kind of one has to try to assess how do the different countries that have related challenges deal with them. But I think we'll be kicking the can down the road probably a little longer than others, because at this stage, we think that's the easiest path forward. I'm not suggesting that's what we should do, but I think that's what
we should do. Does it change simply when the boomers die off? Is that what it takes?
No.
You know, where the next generation of people become a bigger voting vote force than the boomers are today, who are going to vote to keep their entitlements. When that next generation says, hey, and there's more of them, I'm tired of funding you.
Yeah, but keep in mind that retirees tend to vote much more than the young people do. And so it's going to take a little while till we're through that. And by the way, I agree with Steen. One of the things, I mean, I talked about World War III and whatnot, but let's be on a more short-term, pragmatic, and practical basis. Society changes. When you're 65 years old, you don't have money to retire anymore, and so you continue working. Nowadays, we say, oh, my God, how horrible it is. I am almost certain that in 10, 15 years from now, if you talk to a 70-year-old and ask whether they're retired, that's you're going to get a similar reaction as if we were to tell a woman nowadays, are you a housewife? And says, no, of course I'm working. I'm a productive member of society. Well, 50 years ago, you only needed one breadwinner to make a living. Nowadays, you need to continue to work when you're 70. And we live longer, and we should be working longer, but it's going to be a virtue. It's not going to be something, oh, my God, we have failed. So the society is embracing some of that. So not all of that has to end in crisis. The society just has to adjust to it.
My wife would quickly counter that housewives are very productive members of society.
By all means, yeah.
Can, just on your question on whether it's the 1970s, I actually think there will be a huge socioeconomic change, but this is the opposite this time. It's deflation. And one of the questions Mike raised this morning with Chris was that, you know, why do we want inflation? We want inflation because we don't want the opposite, to be honest. We don't want deflation, especially not in the U.S. with the unfunded liabilities where the debt continues to grow. So because of the stock, you don't want deflation. What you are getting is exactly deflation. If you look at total factor productivity again, the developed world, the old world, actually have negative productivity growth, which means the world is deflationary. You are deflationary in yourself because you're chasing and going to seminars like this, trying to make the easy buck. Then on top of this, you have now Asia going through and carrying the world. You know, the person from Singapore has to get free drinks from all of you tonight, because seeing Asia on his own carried the world through this crisis. In 2012, 60% of all growth in the world came from Asia. Now they're not even refusing, they can't do it anymore. They're rebalancing the economy. And as a rebalancing economy, they send you a huge deflationary shock. And the big catalyst to all the questions raised this day is going to be that China is going to devalue the currency by 20% over the next 2 years. Put that into the equation of low volatility and everything else, and you'll see how this will change the mix up. And I'm absolutely certain this will happen. Because first of all, China is fed up with South Korea and Japan benefiting from a easy currency policy. And secondly, in China, there's no reforms. There's zero reforms. Actually, they're consolidating the party power in China. And if there will be changes, it will be in the second half of the 10-year this present elite Politburo sits with, because that's the way it is in China. First, you inherit 50% of the old Politburo, and then you can make your own statement. So we are 4 or 5 years away from China coming back. China is not going to fall by the wayside, but they will have a huge rebalancing, which again is deflationary. On top of that, you end up with what Mike going to talk about tomorrow, demographics. You have, with Europe, you have horrible demographics over the next 20 years. So unless you wake up and invest locally, unless you get away from chasing the 20% of the companies which are listed, you are doomed. I agree. But I'm just saying, I think you're smarter than that. I think you're going to go back from this seminar investing in people you believe in technology, and actually looking away from living this line online and going to the real life. I think we live in a Facebook economy where, you know, it's more about how you update, how you feel, instead of how you really feel, or actually going to your children's keeping the dog shelter in Palo Alto.
Now, there's luckily a point I completely disagree with, so maybe we can. It's not the shelter story, but the China story, and that's luckily what makes a market. The Chinese, every policymaker around the world tries to do the best thing for their country. Even the folks at the Fed do. They're just captive of their own philosophical, political framework. They're captive of their own dynamics. And if you look at what the Chinese policymakers are doing, they have been taking all the right steps in the right directions in recent years. And they're doing it at an increasing pace. Now, they might be not doing it as fast as we would like because we're always impatient. But I don't think they're going to devalue their currency. I think the currency is going to appreciate. So I'm glad I'll be on the other side of that trade. The recent volatility has been intentionally induced, moving away from a manipulated market where you had a highly geared transactions happening that are absolutely useless. And of course, when you move away from those, you're moving towards a more stable or more hedged environment. If you want to move to a free float, people, or to a major currency, people always talk about the exchange rate. Well, the exchange rate, that's the last step along a long path. One of the most beautiful things about the U.S. economy is you can take your money out. You're not going to put your money into an economy if you have any doubts that you can take your money out. What you need to have a rule of law. What you need to have is you need to have a more mature banking system. And then you can add some other things on top of that. You need to have a domestic fixed income market. You need to have an offshore fixed income market. You need to have a more sophisticated derivatives exchanges, commodity exchanges. You need to have a way that people can transact. And so the China has been moving in all these metrics. And so you're not going to move to a free float when everybody says your currency is going to move up 20%, but you're going to move to a free float when you have a disagreement like this, where one guy says you're going to go down 20%, the other guy says you're going to go up 20%, because that's when you can finally make a market. You can finally, as a regulator, take a step back and move away from this overly manipulative way to try to manage these things and cause all these distortions. Now, are there some challenges that China has? Well, by all means, there are massive challenges that China has. But they're not going to say, all right, are we going to allow our economy, our currency to be completely debased? I don't think that's their goal. What they need to do is they want to orient their economy towards more domestic consumption, and they do that by allocating credit more efficiently. And the second thing they need to do is they need to hire Ronald Reagan. Now, the reason I say that is you need to give your people a vision on how to move forward. Well, the one thing the Chinese are good at is propaganda. So that's the sort of thing they can do. Now, they have major challenges, but I don't think we have seen the last of China, and I don't think a currency debasement is going to be part of that. For that, we have not seen, looking at the policymakers, we have not seen steps that they have taken. Yes, for now it's down because they need to shake out all these guys that have been piling up on big leverage on this. It's been complete safe trade to just, you capture extra yield. The Chinese are paying for your leverage trade to buy the renminbi. And so they need to move away from that, and for that they need to make people suffer that have gone on the trade.
Chris, you want to go?
Steen, I completely agree that investing locally is hard. It takes work, and throwing your money into a capital market that's got a put on it is easy, lazy. My role here for the next day is going to be, I'm going to be the Lorax of the story. Okay, I heard you talk about multi-factor productivity, and not one of those factors was actually resources. And so we are at a very unique spot in the story where we know now that oil is no longer cheap, right? And we know that because we're past the cheap stuff. And when we get out of just the world of finance and we look at living capital, which includes all the things that the world provides for us, my money has no use to me if I can't buy something with it that's of use to me, right? I would not want to live in Beijing with air quality indexes that are off the chart bad. I think that would be, I don't care how much money you give me, right? So I watched your great movie, Liberty Street LLC, nice name. Bernanke in there says, we want to boost house prices, we want to boost stocks because that'll get more people buying stuff. I get the narrative, but it has no future. Because ultimately that story is we just need more people buying more stuff. So the most important thing I want to get your point of view on is, I think you touched on it again, you redeemed yourself in your last statement, in your first opening part, which was that, if I could boil it down, we could get growth if we wanted to do that, But we're at a point where that might steal from our quality of life, right? Just growing for its own sake is not good. So to me, the dichotomy is between that the great two forces mission is between, are we going to grow or are we going to be more prosperous? And we've been able to have both. They've been coincident. I think that we're at that awkward point where we get to choose between, are we going to have more growth or are we going to be more prosperous? And I don't think we can have both. But as an economist, I'm interested, you skipped right over resources in your opening part. I'm interested in how that factors in.
In my opinion, is everything. I actually think you can explain every single crisis based on resources. I think the reason why we have lower growth is the price of resources. I actually also, someone in disagreement with you, I guess, think that energy prices will come down, if nothing else, just because in the short term, because we have lower growth, lower demand simply. And I think people are overestimating the middle class growth, and Asia certainly is being overestimated. But I think resources can explain everything if you want to go that way. If you look at BP, if you look at Shell, the exploration cost of additional resources is going through the sky. I mean, we're not even talking about multiple or two, we're talking multiple of 20, 30, relatively to the 60s and 70s, as you know better than anyone, Chris. So I think we need to understand, I think water and energy are the two components. And it's actually also explained why Europe is, as someone alluded to this morning, is you know, victim of Russia. I disagree on the final point, which was that Germany will have to do whatever they have to do. Europe actually have a plan B. They have invested over $1 trillion or something in alternative channeling of natural gas from mainly the North Sea. But it's not enough. I agree with that. Europe is short of energy. Russia is long of energy. So let me be the diplomat here. The solution to the Ukraine crisis is very clear. It's not sanctions, which is, you know, something the American president apparently came up with in his usual "I will do something eventually" plan. But the solution is actually to embrace Russia. Europe has all the energy, has all the engineering and the logistic, and Russia is short. And I go to Russia 3 times a year. It's a great country, by the way, but you know, I'm concerned. Resources is important. That's why there will be long-term prosperity for Russia as well. And I think Europe will find its gas in Russia. But that's, you know, 5-10 years down the road from here, and it's through the ice before the fire. Which I always think, you look at history, evolution tells us that we need to get to a crisis point. The 70s through the high energy prices, which was not talked about in the movie, but actually probably drove the inflation through the roof. And I think this time could be similar. So a short spike creating, you know, the necessity to create the opposite. So yes, Chris, I agree. Resources can explain 90% of all everything that goes on in the world in a cyclical basis.
In the far back.
Yeah, I have a comment and a question. I don't know how many people in the room are sort of economists versus money managers, but all this is very interesting. I read all of your work and I love it all. I'd love to hear sprinkled in some more ideas around what we actually do with the money that we manage, right? Because at the end of the day, having ideas and opinions and thoughts isn't what I get really paid for. So anyway, if that can be sprinkled in, great. If not, we can have a long theoretical discussion about how all this
shakes out. I'm the amateur host. That'll be quick.
The question is, you know, if we all closed our eyes for a moment and rethought a world in which we could be wrong, what are the things that you might be looking at, that we could be looking at, that might change your mind? That might actually say, wow, things on the margin might actually begin moving in the direction that would make us feel more positive. So maybe the absolute numbers are bad, our credit bubble charts are horrible, but the rate of change is actually starting to go in the direction that might be a positive. Is it even humanly possible for us to go there?
Can we grow another 100% on the S&P 500? I'll be quick. You know, my concern is it's not about economic growth, which isn't actually correlated well with the stock market. It's about what price are you paying for assets. And I think it's interesting, this idea of the easy investment, very liquid, securities, I think, you know, have been more favored by Fed subsidies than others. So my way of viewing it is that there's a lot of risk built into equities, especially. But emerging markets are cheap. They're levered to the developed world economic growth, so they could take a hit in the next year or two. But if you're really an investor and not a trader, I think emerging markets are a simple buy. I love the lack of complacency in the long end of the U.S. Treasury bond curve, so I've invested there a little bit. It's very risky, but something to do with a small portion of your assets. If we go down the Japanese path, anyone long-term Japanese bonds has done really well for the last 10 or 15 years. I don't think it's a trade for 30 years, but it could be a trade for 5. Cash is great in an inflationary environment because you can reinvest it. And it's also great in deflation. So I think cash is attractive, and some commodities and gold to hedge against all these things.
So So, and in short response to some of what you're asking, two pieces. One is in terms of what could be surprising. Frankly, you know, our estimate of 2.4% 10-year S&P 500 returns is predicated on the assumption of 6.3-ish nominal annual GDP growth. Economic growth. I don't think we're going to be surprised on the upside unless that surprises inflation. And my impression is, to go to Chris's point, that resources are essential in the sense that, given that we have the amount of monetary base that we've had, and we've gone down the liquidity preference curve as far as we have, which is zero all the way out from about 12 cents of monetary base per dollar GDP all the way out to what's now more than double that. We're not going to see short-term interest rates higher anytime soon. And the Fed can keep this that pressure on short-term interest rates for quite some time. So bonds are going to give you about 2.6% if you hold them over next decade. You can't squeeze more water out of that turnip because that's what the yield to maturity is. Equities are likely to deliver from these prices fairly low returns. So we're living in a world where prospective returns have been, because of this Fed-induced yield seeking, where prospective returns across investment categories has been pressed down. It is what it is, precisely because you see prices where they are, right? As an investment manager, that forces you to ask the question, well, if I can't get those returns from a buy and hold investment strategy, if I can't get higher than 2 point something from a diversified portfolio of all kinds of assets, whether you go equities, bonds, corporate debt, and so forth, then you have to think about, well, is there some opportunity to use cyclical fluctuation to my advantage, whether that's long-term cyclical fluctuation like we do full cycle stuff, whether that's commodity type CTA fluctuation, which is over much shorter horizons. But it does, I think, argue for a larger allocation or a larger consideration of alternative assets during this span. Once we get to a point where asset valuations are depressed, where prospective returns can be read off of securities or can be calculated, and there are some things that we'll talk about tomorrow in terms of calculating prospective returns, once we get to a point where a buy and hold amount of risk is actually likely to be compensated well, then you can shift that portfolio allocation back toward long only. That kind of strategy is actually what has worked well, or would have worked well, over the period from about 1998 to today, sort of varying between a heavier exposure to alternative assets around 2000, 2001, moving toward more conventional assets when prospective returns were higher, moving back away in the 06, 07 period, and then moving back toward more conventional asset allocations, after the crisis. But it is going to likely require some attention to calculation. Benjamin Graham said basically that when it comes to matters of investment, the proper strategy is not hope but calculation. And so there are ways to calculate prospective returns, and we really, as money managers, ought to be thinking very carefully about those kinds of things and how we might switch from portfolio allocations that emphasize alternatives to portfolio allocations that emphasize long only. I hope that's helpful.
I can just throw in a few thoughts here. First of all, to answer one of the questions, what would change my mind on many of the predictions that I make in the U.S. if we shifted from a society based on consumption that's focused on savings and investment? The unfortunate thing is it's always the next politician that's supposed to take care of that. And if we saw a sea change in that, and that could happen, for example, if we incentivize savings and punish consumption, a national energy tax or sales tax, those are the sort of symptoms one should look for a change. Beyond that, I happen to think that bonds are going to be one of the worst investments over the next 10 years, but I'm 100% in line with the rationale that John is bringing. You need to find other ways to diversify your portfolio because the expected returns in traditional asset classes are low, partially because of the valuations, and then there's no easy answer. As he points out, you can do that with being more focused on cyclicals. You can be more focused on commodities. We do it on currencies, and specifically we have two currency funds that are for investors who think we have a better printing press of the world than the rest of the world. We have two funds that if you think we have currency wars and you can be more tactical. We're coming to a market in 2 weeks that we can't talk about, but we can. We're ringing the bell on the New York Stock Exchange on May 19th. If you want to know about that product, I'll be glad to give you information if you give me your card. That's more in the precious metals arena that we think is going to be very well received in this audience, for example. So there are things that are available and in the market. I'm not here to make product pitches, so I can't get too much into detail, but I'll be glad to talk with you offline.
John just reminded me of the voting machine versus weighing machine analogy that I think. Is that Buffett who said? Or is it Graham? I'm not sure. So in the short term, it's a voting machine. In the long term, it's a weighing machine. And I think John's talking about there's times you want to invest for a voting environment, and there's times you want to invest for a weighing environment. I think the market's set to start weighing things.
Well, it's that Roe versus Sale that Easterling does, that's great. But I guess the issue is, has the 20 PE become the new 15? I mean, when do we at the end of the day, investors give advisors their money.
The answer is sorry. We'll definitely discuss it more tomorrow.
All right.
Because we don't want to spoil all